I'm going to start with a broad, general question here. Coming off a national championship, your thoughts on the 2020 LSU Tigers, defections, new players, COVID, and all SEC schedule. I know that is broad as can be, but yeah. Who and what are the 2020 LSU Tigers?
Well, I mean, that's the question, right? Because I thought LSU had a lot of unknown 2 years ago coming into the season when you were working in new quarterback, new coordinator, basically new starters at every position. But now, this season, you now, after these recent defections, and really this is where it's a perfectly timed question, because the Jamar Chase news and Tyler Shelvin news, which we'll get into, that has changed my outlook on who this Tiger team is. But when you look, you now have a Tiger team that is down to 70 scholarship players out of the available 85. You are returning just 5 starters from last year's national championship team. You lost Joe Brady. You bring in Scott Linehan, who has been coaching changes as well. And then obviously you're going from Joe Burrow, the greatest LSU player of all time, to an unknown commodity in Miles Brennan, one that just lost his best weapon. So the unfortunate answer to who are these LSU Tigers is we don't really know. Now, I still believe that they have a great amount of talent on this team, but that, and that's why I was still very hopeful on this season, like 8-2, something like that. But that took a major hit when you lose Jamar Chase, who is your best NFL prospect on the team, definitely the best on offense, and then Tyler Shelvin, who arguably was your best draft eligible defensive prospect. So it's been a hell of a news cycle for LSU, and Coach O's ability to sustain success is going to be tested in an immediate and intense way here 1 year after that national championship.
Let's talk about the schedule. Look, I know people don't like this, but you took away the rent a win games, if you will, and you've got just the gauntlet of SEC. Now, you can make the argument that LSU's 2 extra SEC games are favorable for them, but you don't have any time against any of these sub-conferences to maybe find your footing, so to say. How much does the schedule, is it a detriment? Is it just kind of another obstacle where they're going to have a lot of new players learning at the highest level? And what kind of challenge is that?
You know, I actually think that when it comes to the schedule, that LSU is the big winner. Now, you are absolutely correct in that it has become harder replacing those winner in games with a 10-game conference schedule. Consequently, as a viewer, I think it's also actually become more attractive. But as far as LSU is concerned, it didn't just become harder on them. It became harder on everybody, right? And so if everybody's going to be working from a more difficult place, then you got to acknowledge that LSU ends up with the best path of that more difficult place. I mean, you start – first off, you add Mizzou and at Vandy. I mean, you literally could not have chosen 2 better teams that were not on your schedule currently. Then you mentioned not you having a cupcake game to ramp up. That is true, but the ramp up here is still pretty nice for LSU. You're going to open with Mike Leach, Mississippi State, which is very attractive to me from a viewing standpoint. And I'm a little more worried than others seem to be, but Vegas has just a 26-point favorite. So you open with Mississippi State, then you go to Vandy, then you host Mizzou, and then you get into the meat of your schedule when you're talking about Florida. And so really, LSU's schedule has a really nice rhythm to it where you have a ramp up, it's really tough in the middle, and then you almost have like a descending recovery. So if they can win some of those big games in the middle, like Florida, like Alabama, then the schedule will position them to contend for championships. So it is harder overall, like it is for everybody, but how it came together, I think was actually a huge win for LSU.
All right, just a couple more questions here, because this has been more than fantastic so far. Miles Brennan obviously came in so heralded out of Bay St. Louis and in St. Stanislaus High School. Obviously, maybe it was a little too much too soon. Burrow comes in. I think it's a good thing that he got the opportunity to maybe learn from Joe Burrow, time to develop. Where do you stand on Miles Brennan being a not just a starting SEC quarterback, but potentially becoming an elite SEC quarterback? Following a legend is always hard, and that's what he's going to have to do. But where do you stand on your assessment and evaluation as somebody who snapped the ball to the quarterback for so many years?
Yeah, you know, and I should be clear, I should preface this with, you know, I've gotten to see him in some limited practice action. I've seen him in the game reps from last year. So that's what I'm coming from here, right? Ultimately, we have a lot more information a couple weeks into the season. But everything that I've heard or seen anecdotally, I think speaks well to what Miles has done the last couple of years. He didn't transfer. He recognized that he had a guy in front of him who was just, you know, just better in Joe Burrow. And instead of kind of shying away from that, I think he embraced it. And there's a lot of stories out there about how he really learned from Joe, like his routine, his preparation, how he deals with teammates, with leadership decisions. And he's going to look to carry those lessons forward. The interesting thing is, he could do what and this is why it's just impossible for him, though, this year, is that he could do 60% of what Joe Burrow did. And I want to say that puts him at, like, around 3,500 yards, like, almost 40 touchdowns. Let's say he even, like, doubles the picks. And it's like, that's a great season. LSU fans would have killed for that 2 years ago. And yet here you sit, and that would feel so wildly different than last season. So he always had an uphill battle. I do believe he's physically capable, but ultimately you got to go prove it. Why I think, though, this Ja'Marr Chase opt-out is so impactful is because of Miles Brennan. Like, we asked this question, was it more, which was more impactful, Chase or Shelvin leaving? And when you look at the impact that Chase has, the knock-on effect, yes, his departure raises opportunity for guys like Terrace Marshall and Arik Gilbert. There are more stats to be had now. But also, there's a lot more defensive resources to go around now. Ja'Marr Chase was going to be like a magnet, basically demanding that the defense recognize and attack him. Otherwise, he'll beat you. Like Brennan, and this is why it's so impactful for him, he lost an unbelievable security blanket. If he ever got the read that Ja'Marr Chase was one-on-one, he didn't need to think about anything else. Like, he could just go there, and that would be the correct decision. That is now out the window. So Terrace Marshall takes on more pressure. Arik Gilbert, the freshman, takes on more pressure. Racy McMath, who is going to be a wide receiver three. Now you think two, he, and then whoever can fill that third spot. So Miles Brennan already had an uphill battle. It didn't get any easier with the pandemic of disrupting the offseason. It didn't get any easier switching to a 10-game SEC schedule. And then it didn't get any easier losing a top five NFL talent, you know, basically 2 weeks before the season started. So I think that he's capable. It's hard to say that it's likely from where we sit today.
That was amazing. I got to ask you one more question before we go here, because I think people are going to be curious. What is your dog's name? And that's a very lovely cat, although that's a big, big cat right there.
He's a big boy, dude. That's Gerald. He comes from the streets of Baton Rouge back when I was in college, back in 2009. We've been together 11 years now. He was meowing at me, and I had some string cheese in my hand, and I fed him said cheese, and well, it's just been it's been love ever since. Even though he's more like kind of like a roommate, the dog feels a little more like a kid. That's Chewbacca, Chewy for short, which ended up being, I think, like a self-fulfilling prophecy, because when he was younger, he ruined a very expensive couch chewing it up. He ruined blinds. He ate a remote one time. He's very good now, though, but Yeah. These are the boys, dude. That's the crew.
There you go. I'm glad everybody got to see him and that they didn't interrupt it. It's just kind of like they just, you know, they knew the camera was on. They gravitated right towards it.
Yeah, I think y'all called me at a lucky time. Also, none of my kids are here. So I got like a quiet house right now. It's nice.
All right. And this is my final question, I promise. I love covering the Pelicans. I know you love covering the Pelicans, and I know you are, like, invested in the NBA, which is fantastic. I love talking about the NBA with people. Your moments of breakdown during the Pelicans' end of their season, was it just impromptu, or was there some thought process? Because some of the lighting and some of the moments with the beverages and things like that, I have to admit, they were some of my happiest moments, because the Pelicans did not provide us with a lot of happiness in the bubble.
No, it's I would say that it is a bit of a mixture. Whereas, like, you got to understand, I approach the Pelicans purely from a fan perspective, right? I don't know enough about basketball to claim to be like an objective analyst on what works or not. And so because of that, I party during Pelicans games. I just love to drink when I watch the Pelicans. And so all of those videos are just the result of me being drunk and angry or drunk and sad and just thinking what would be kind of fun. I mean, the most honest video that probably had no planning whatsoever was the spitting out the beer video. Like that was just, I just could not find a way to better express my emotions after what I watched the Clippers do to the Pelicans that first half when it mattered so much. And it's a huge bummer for me because I am a fan and I want the franchise to be successful. And they had such an opportunity to gain mind share and heart share in New Orleans and in Louisiana. And they just blew it in the bubble and it sucks, but you know what? I still believe in the long-term future. It's just that that's a way harder sell than if they had actually lived up to what a lot of us were thinking going into that bubble.
T-Bob, you are one of my favorite people in media. I still wish you were in New Orleans. I just can't thank you enough for taking a few minutes here. I'm going to put all of this online, and then for our segment, we have a special coming up, a football preview, Saints LSU Tulane, and that's when I'm going to kind of edit up more of that LSU stuff. But dude, this has been fantastic. I can't thank you enough.
No, dude, Fletch, come on. And you know the feeling is that
I know, but still, you just don't understand. Like, I know you know you're good. I don't feel like you need that. But, like, literally, I remember, like, one of the first times I interviewed you was leaving Mississippi State, like, in 2011. And you had, like, you were reading a Lord of the Rings book.
I was reading Game of Thrones.
Game of Thrones, that's what I mean. And I'm like, this guy's just different. You know what I mean? Because I think people know your dad so much. And look, I love your dad. Your dad's been great to me since he got here in 05. But, like, I think people, like, one, your dad's memory is insane. He remembers games. He's talking
it's
about,
that
like,
NFL, it's that NFL quarterback memory, dude.
Dude, he's talking about plays from the USFL and stuff. You know what I mean? Yeah. But the thing is people hear, like, the Cajun man accent, and I always get upset when they kind of think, like, oh, they think Adam Sandler and the Waterboy, and it's just the opposite. But, like, you, like, one, don't sound like that, but I've always felt like, dude, this guy, because sometimes people think, oh, offensive lineman, just the big kind of meathead guy.
Yeah.
Stereotypes blow me away so much that people kind of want to pigeonhole people into things. And it's like, dude, if you knew, like, T-Bob and the layers, it's like people that, like, oh, the offensive lineman, kind of the big, it's like, dude, there's just so much more. Or like, well, Bobby. Or like, well, even.
So this is where I got to give my old man credit, though, because even though he was a super athletic guy, quarterback, all this stuff, he always encouraged my interests, right? Like when I got into Warhammer, wanted to paint miniatures or video games or this or that, like he encouraged it all. He allowed my nerdness to flourish. One of the greatest days of my life, why I have this shirt on right now, when they re-released the original trilogy of Star Wars in theaters, he took me out of school to get to go see him. And then afterwards took me to Toys R Us. And this is like one of the greatest days of my life. I guess the benefits of being like a quarterback's kid. Cause he was like, okay, you get one toy. And so I chose whatever it was, right? And then he's like a kid in those situations. He's like, well, if you get that, then you gotta have the X-Wing. Well, and you get that, then you gotta have this, you gotta have that. We left with a shopping cart full. I think one of almost every Star Wars toy they had in there. So he gave me the ability to just completely be myself, and that's been pretty awesome because it's allowed me to just do what I love, which is like sports and nerd stuff.